as I was preparing this, what I was going to say today, I received the news of the passing of the former governor, Mario Cuomo, which saddened me. Mario Cuomo was a unique person in the fact he was, as many New Yorkers understood him, a true Renaissance man, capable of engaging in discourse on almost any subject, and capable of understanding and thinking deep thoughts. But as I heard the news, I was brought back to a time back in 1977, which Lynn will remember, when a fellow by the name of Zeke Boyd was running for the mayor of New York City. And he was running against Ed Koch and Mario Cuomo. And the day after the election, Mario Cuomo paid Zeke and this movement some homage, in which he said, in a radio interview, he said, "Well, you know, I don't know about these results, but I woke up this morning and I thought that Zeke Boyd had won the election." Now, you don't, not very many people mention LaRouche candidates or anything like that, but this was the character of Mario Cuomo. But I want to harken back to another point when they were having one of these debates. At that point, you know, they had radio as a major player in this, and Zeke was there, and Mario Cuomo was there, and Koch was there. Now, Koch, and people should remember, is sort of like, if you think of him, you should think of him as like an evil clown. Mm-hmm. I mean, what else can you think of? A guy that is the mayor and rides on the subway with a pink bunny rabbit, large stuffed pink bunny rabbit. So Koch is not somebody that either Cuomo likes, and certainly Zeke did. And Zeke went in this debate, he went at this question of what was being done to New York City as a result of the capitulation of political leaders to fascist bankers who were at that point under the dictate of the Emergency Control Board in control of the city. And he said, "My city is being destroyed, and that we must rally people because we shall not allow for the payment of blood for debt." That's pretty strong stuff. And after the debate, Governor Cuomo, well, he wasn't governor then, Mario Cuomo came up and he says to me, he said, "You know, I agree with much of what Zeke said." So I said, "Well, why don't you say it?" He said, "I can't say that. But you guys have to keep saying it, because nobody else will." Now, what that reflects is two things. Mario Cuomo was perhaps the best of many people who could have taken a position on what was going on and could have rallied other people specifically behind the kinds of programs that we were putting forward, but he did not. The function of leadership is to do what we do and to do what we have done. We were fighting for this city and continue to fight for this city where it has to be fought, in the streets. We fight for the minds of its people, but we fight for the survival of this city. And in our fight for that survival, this organization was born. And in reality, when we're talking about the BRICS nations and what was accomplished, what they've accomplished and what the pathway that they're offering us, that pathway and those policies come from that fight in this city. And they come from this city. New York is not merely an important city in the United States, it is the true capital of this country, in the sense that here rests the intellectual integrity and the sense of what the mission of what this country is about. I mean, There are two symbols of this country that are important, more important than the White House or the Capitol building in Washington or anything, or the Washington Monument or Mount Rushmore or some things like that. Those symbols are the Statue of Liberty and Ellis Island. Because this nation is what New York City made it. We were created not as a refuge, but as an outpost intended to change the world, this country. That was the intention of those people who founded, who were seeking the founding of this country. They had an idea about founding, such people as Nicholas Apuza, who conceived of the country as an idea long before it ever came into being. And New York City represents that idea, right? Now, leadership is not merely from a person, right? This is a little bit difficult to understand. Leaders are not necessarily merely people. New York City, for what it represents to this country, for what it represents to the world, is a leader and must be a leader again, which is why it became the target that it did and why this city was savaged by the British host that's not so far from where we reside right now in Lower Manhattan. But the question of leadership, Mario Cuomo failed, but we didn't fail, right? And we will not fail, but we have to understand how we came to where we are right now. And a lot of that is not really well known because people forget. Not because they want to forget, but because they were never told. Many of you don't know this story, so we're going to tell you a story, but I want to situate it a little bit before we begin that story. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to try and show you, I want to counter something specifically today. I want to give every one of you the opportunity to counter the total bullshit when somebody tells you that, well, we suffered a lot under Big Mac, but Giuliani especially and Bloomberg especially, they made this city work again. Now you hear it. You know, you'll hear it. Go ask people. People believe that crap. Why? Because the New York Times says so. The media in general says so. But I'm going to give you some indication of what has been done to the city. And it's not going to be complete because I haven't had the time to complete it. It's a lot of work because you got to sift through all the lies. But you'll have at least ammunition to say that this city needs to be saved. And the way it's going to be saved is by saving this country and saving the world. And there is only one way to do this, which is to defeat and destroy Wall Street and all the people who run it, and to change the direction of policy towards the direction that this movement and Lyndon LaRouche proposed way back some 50 years ago, yeah, and have been fighting for this last 50 years. All right, well, let's start by making some general points that situate the city. The city has played a major role that there have in what amounts to four revolutions that have taken place in this country. And they are revolutions, because what defines a revolution? Revolution is a fundamental change, right? An overthrowing of a system, and a change. It's a movement. That's what is accomplished by something that's called a revolution. The first revolution is pretty obvious, right? That was the revolution against the British Crown, the rebellion, as the British call it. Right, that's what they call it. They call it the rebellion. They don't even acknowledge that it really took place. And that of course, led to the creation of this country. But what created this country was the, in specific, what consolidated what had been won on the battlefield were the actions of, and the ideas put into motion of Alexander Hamilton about the organization of an economy. Alexander Hamilton was, of course, a New Yorker. And what he did was he created a system which became known later time as the American system of physical economy. That system is based upon something completely different than what the British call their own system or monetarism. That system is a system that is based upon the idea that human creativity is the real source of wealth, and that wealth is not something that is counted as much as it is an action, right? A process by which progress is achieved. And this economy that Alexander Hamilton created is embodied in our Constitution and our other founding documents around two central principles. The first principle is something called the pursuit of happiness. Now, this is not some Walmart smiley face, right? This is not feeling good, smiling, being happy. That's, you know, I'm happy. No, that's not what we're talking about. This, the pursuit of happiness, as meant and as referred to as one of our inalienable rights, as discussed in the Declaration of Independence, is the perfectibility of man's soul and his knowledge, and the application of that knowledge to create a future. Leibniz, the great philosopher, Gottfried Leibniz, discusses this, and this is where the term comes from. It doesn't come from, you know, it's a product of this kind of thought that man is a perfectible creature. This country is committed to this idea, right? And the second idea that is central to the Hamiltonian system is the principle of the general welfare, which means that no policy undertaken by the national government can be undertaken unless it meets the criterion of serving all of our people, not any class of people, not any group of people, but all of our people, not merely in the present sense, but into the future. In other words, that it serves a posterity. So in other words, the country is about perfecting man and creating from that act, those act of perfection, creating a future. That's the core of principle in the Hamiltonian system. Now, in order to accomplish this, what he does is he creates a system which is based upon credit. Why? Because credit is something which is an extension of the present into the future. And under the Hamiltonian system, you use credit to create intentionally a future. So you have an idea about what you want to do. So he's saying that our future rests in how we deploy credit. So what do we need? We need a form of organization of our country that's amenable to the most efficient use of this system. And that's a federal union, not a series of states, localities, cities, or anything else, but a federal union as an indivisible whole from which policy does not come from below, it comes from the top to affect the entirety of this federal union. How do we do this? Well, we need a system of national banking. Not merely a national bank, but a system of national banking. And what does that mean? That means that you are going to have a system to deploy this credit for purposes that you intend on a national basis. And that's really what a national banking is about. So you have a national bank. It is not the national bank, as proposed by Hamilton, is not a government institution, right? It is, in fact, a government chartered institution, but its purpose is not the making of profit for the bank. It makes some, but its purpose is to serve this intentional national interest. Now, the battle for this, the battle to create this nation has always been centered in New York. Not anywhere else, in New York. In other words, the fight has always been against an enemy which was put into New York, a host, if you will, a different concept of banking, which is this bank, you know, which we see down on Lower Manhattan now. You have banks which act solely for the purpose of making profits for their shareholders and so forth. The whole idea of that concept of banking, British banking, is to make profit at whatever cost. At whatever cost, be it the cost of human life, that profit is to be made. Now, Lynn was saying something which you may want to think about, because you know, when you mention all these numbers, they don't sometimes you don't get the right idea. All right. Debt is secured by what? Is secured by some kind of asset. An asset is something which exists either, you know, does not necessarily exist at this moment alone, but exists into the future. All right. So, Lynn said that, described the total gross product, which is the asset which must secure a debt. And she's talking about debts of the quadrillion. I don't even remember the number. But here's a way to think about it. Take a ping pong ball. If the ping pong ball is the total physical asset that must secure the debt, then according to what we're now calculating, the size of the debt that it must secure is the planet Jupiter. Now, what do you see anything commensurable about these two things? Not exactly, right? They are incommensurable. It's not possible to actually support any, you know, that kind of size of debt. Yet the British system demands that you extract something for this debt. Now, why I'm going through all of this will be clear in a few minutes. All right, so that's the first American Revolution, fought out by Hamilton to secure the country. First, to create a constitution which creates this indivisible union. This is mostly the work of him and some other people as well, but it's his idea about this concept of the indivisible union, federal union, and to create an economy as our first Treasury Secretary for the purpose of having to secure this union and create some basis for progress for all the citizens, not citizens of each state to be taken as each state, not citizens of New York, for example. Some of you also should find out. I didn't look it up, but I'm sure somebody could find it out. Why this state is called the Empire State? Who did that? Because this state is not, I mean, maybe somebody conceives it, not Hamilton, he didn't conceive this as an empire. The whole idea that sounds to me, you know, some, what?
Very British.
Yeah, very British.
Yeah.
All right. But, so the Hamilton creates this, Hamilton creates this economy, it's fought against, right? It's fought against by the Wall Street host, right? Which is this collection of bankers. But it's wrong to think of Wall Street as the source of the problem, because it's not. The source of the problem is the British Empire. The British Empire uses Wall Street, it operates through Wall Street. Wall Street doesn't run anything, it is in turn run, and what is its intention is to always work against this country. All right, so that's the first revolution. And that takes place when? It takes place from approximately 1775 till the death of Hamilton, which is 1801. Now who kills Hamilton, right? A British agent who happens to be the Vice President of the United States, who was in fact brought before the Senate on charges of treason as a British agent. And only through the work of Wall Street buying members of the Senate was he not convicted of treason. That's the man who kills Hamilton, Aaron Burr. Right?
Press
stop version. Press, well, good. But he wasn't. We don't think he's that old. We're not sure. He might be. You never know. The Bush family has, as his father, as George W.'s father says, it has hardy genes. I don't think he's talking about Levi's either. But anyway, going back to what we're saying. So that's the first revolution, right? Now, I'm not going to go through a whole history of the United States, but I want to make sure that you understand these, because all of these, this involves New York City, all right? So, the second revolution is the Lincoln Revolution, right? What the Lincoln Revolution does is it puts down an organized rebellion against the Union, right? Which is the Confederacy, an attempt to, what is it fighting? It's fighting against this principle of the indivisible Union, right? To break apart the Union is a British strategy. The person who advises Lincoln, who creates the system of credit that Lincoln uses, the National Bank has been destroyed. By who? By a conspiracy run out of New York under the direction of Aaron Burr's protege, Martin Van Buren, running this idiot, Andrew Jackson, right? The National Bank is destroyed. It doesn't exist. So the credit distribution system has broken down. Lincoln is under the advice of the greatest economist of the 19th century, Henry Charles Carey, right? Who is a disciple of Hamilton, but who explicitly understands that the enemy is the British Empire and British monetarism. And so what he does is he organizes Lincoln on a number of critical issues, including ways that he understands both the protection of American industry from British markets. The banks in New York, the British banks, are merchant banks. What they attempt to do is secure market. For who? For British product, for the British, to crush nascent American industry. So Henry Carey proposes protections, right? Tariffs to block the British from destroying our industry. He also understands that the Union, to be a whole, must be bound together. There must be the means of commerce. You can't have a state over here and a state over there, and they have no means to conduct commerce in a joint process. So it's Carey who pushes further the idea of a transcontinental railroad, which Lincoln heartily embraces and undertakes in the middle of the Civil War to build this railroad, because he understands that this is necessary if the Union is truly to be able to survive. Now, New York in this. New York is organizing the rebellion from Wall Street, right? New York is organizing on the other side to support Lincoln. New York provides the largest amount, New York City provides the largest amount of troops of any single place in the country for the Union cause. It also provides the Union with the fellow who designed our Central Park, right? Frederick Olmsted. Frederick Olmsted goes to work at the request of Carey, who contacts him, and what he does is he builds up the Union capability to treat wounded soldiers. And if that becomes a critical difference in the Civil War, right? Because Confederate soldiers, if you got wounded, you died. The Union soldiers, less than 15% because of the work of Olmsted in organizing the supplies and the ability to organize field hospitals and to treat wounded Union soldiers, helps conserve the most precious resource. Again, understanding this from what? From a Hamiltonian perspective. What is the most precious resource that we have? Gold? No, it's human beings, people. And this is done. All right. At the same time, an operation is thwarted by people in New York City, in which there's a proposal by the mayor, who's a creature of Wall Street, is a guy by the name of Ward, to make New York City a Venetian-style city-state, to secede from the New York State and from the Union as a separate, almost a separate country, like Venice. Right, this was the idea of this guy, the mayor, and the network of bankers that supported it. But, don't worry about it.
It's in your pocket.
Yes, yeah, it's in the show. I don't know. The most important figure from Wall Street in that particular fight is a banker by the name of August Belmont, who's effectively the head of British operations in the United States. He's the person who organizes the assassination of Lincoln. He's the person who is providing funding and resources to break the blockade, to provide weapons to the Confederacy. And he is a continuous buyer of political figures and is the head of the Democratic Party. Okay? He's the head of the Democratic Party in the United States in the period immediately after the Civil War, organizing against what? Organizing against Lincoln's greenback policy, which is Lincoln's credit policy given him by Carey, and also against all forms of protectionism to attempt to savage American industry, and also to, on the speech, what?
I'm sorry, what was his name again?
August Belmont.
Thank you very much.
The guy that says the racetrack's named for it. He created that. Yeah. So every time you go there,
His daughter was
right.
In England all the
right.
Time.
That's the Belmont family.
Right. Yeah.
Right. That's right. Okay. So there's the fight is continuing, right? Okay. The third revolution, right? But again, the important thing is Lincoln won, right? The rebellion was put down. Carey's policies enabled the country to have economic progress even after Lincoln was murdered by the British. And there's this ongoing battle of subversion conducted by Wall Street again, okay? And the enemies of those people are people that are starting to come up as part of the organized labor movement and so forth, which are fighting against, fighting for justice and so forth, for working people to against the policies of, you know, against the policies of Wall Street, even at that early stage, right? The third revolution is the Roosevelt Revolution, okay? Now, Roosevelt, of course, was a New Yorker. Spent most of his time where we're going tomorrow, up in Hyde Park. But he spent a lot of time in New York City and had a great affinity for this city. Roosevelt's revolution was necessary because Wall Street was and the British were attempting to take advantage of the conditions brought on by their own policies, which had caused the Depression collapse, to create a new fascist system in the United States and to destroy the American government, as had been done, for example, in Germany. Roosevelt understood that the enemy were what he called economic royalists, and he sought to destroy their power to dictate policy to the federal government. And he also sought to restore the faith of the American people in their government. And Roosevelt, the New Yorker, put one of the places that was a battleground in this was, in terms of the success of the policies, was New York City itself. Many of the economic programs, the WPA programs, for example, were sent, 25% of all the projects that the WPA were in New York City, at least in the first 8-6 years of those projects. I mean, you see what they built all around you. 200 schools, 100 post offices, LaGuardia Airport, the port facility, expansion of the port facilities, expansion of the Brooklyn Navy Yard. All of these things were undertaken by Roosevelt's administration with the assistance and in collaboration with the mayor of New York, Fiorello LaGuardia, who, despite the fact he wasn't a Democrat, worked with Roosevelt, supported him, because he understood the necessity of doing these things. More than 1 million units of public housing were built as a result of impetus from the use of federal credit to build this as public housing to replace the dilapidated New York City housing stock, some of which dated back to well before the Civil War. So these accomplishments, right, were a result of the policies that Roosevelt sought to give the federal government the ability to carry out the kind of development that were necessary to secure the future as he saw it. And the key to this,
sorry? One more thing, the hospitals.
Yes, I didn't mention that. He built 15 public hospitals.
Yeah.
I mean, I could list all the things. Schools, hospitals. Yeah. He built the air. I told you, LaGuardia Airport. All of these things were built as projects. I mean, much of what you see in the city is still there, right? These things are still there.
Beautiful buildings on Western Avenue, the Upper
right.
West Side. Beautiful.
Right. Now, what I wanted to also make the point is that what Lynn was talking about Glass-Steagall. Glass-Steagall was Roosevelt's weapon, along with a couple of other things that he did, against Wall Street. His intention was to break the power of Wall Street by preventing them from being protected in their speculation. The intent was to take the power away from Wall Street to do what it would as a speculative force by separating the functions of banking. If Wall Street wanted to speculate, it wasn't going to be with the deposits of the American people. Now remember what happened when Roosevelt came to office. The country was on the edge of a total meltdown of its financial system. Banks were were closing, people were in a state of panic, there were insufficient funds to service their accounts in the banks. And so what Roosevelt immediately did is he shut the banks down. And he made sure that this was universal in that he shut down the Federal Reserve Bank of the city of New York. He shut it down. He ordered it shut down the first day that he was in office. The Federal Reserve Bank refused to shut down. So Roosevelt sent the message, either you're shut tomorrow morning or there will be troops sent to your door to shut you. They shut down. And he did this to demonstrate the power of the federal government, the federal union, to dictate policy as necessary, as part of the, on behalf of the general welfare, against, to show that bankers were not more powerful than the government, especially not more powerful than this president. And he also understood that he was, in fact, saving the financial system. Later, he makes a speech in New York City at Madison Square Garden during the 1936 campaign, and he says, look, I saved many bankers. I'm reminded of the story now, because now these same bankers want to shoot me. They're spending huge amounts of money to topple me and to end the New Deal. He says, I'm reminded of the story that of a banker who was walking along the dock with his silk hat and everything, a little bit tipsy, and he falls into the water. And some working guy, stiff, walking along the thing, dives in and picks him out. And he thanks him at the time, and then later, he attacks the guy for failing to save his silk hat. And that's what he told you. That's what he said. He said, these people wanted me. I'm not going to save their silk hat. I saved their rear ends. I'm not saving their silk hat. I mean, the American people have no obligation to protect speculation. And so Roosevelt carefully explained to people that he had a different sense of how to of what value was. And this is, again, consistent with the Hamiltonian principle. A bank has an asset, right? Maybe it's a factory. The factory is closed, right? Factory's closed. According to British accounting, that asset is worth zero. But Roosevelt and the person he chose to try and mediate and control the Federal Reserve, a non-banker, a person who was an industrialist from Utah named Mariner Eccles, they had this idea that assets have value in accordance with the principle of the general welfare. That factory is necessary. Maybe it isn't open now, but it still is important for our economy. It's been closed as a result of financial speculation on Wall Street that have destroyed our economy. We are not going to value that asset as zero. So if a bank holds paper on something like this, we'll assign the real value to it, not some British accountant's value. This is called the value of an asset. And the valuation and valuing an asset in that way, from the standpoint of the general welfare, is how you also consider the deployment of credit, vast amounts of credit. Credit is secured by the issuance of federal credit, or credit generally, is secured by by what it creates in the future. All right. Now, I've explained these things for a purpose, and the purpose is to understand the next revolution. And it is the unfinished revolution. Now, understand the following thing. The American Revolution is not an event. It's a process. It's a process in accordance with this concept of the pursuit of happiness. It's a process of continuous perfection. And it was never intended to be merely about this country or the continental United States. The American Revolution is a universal process whose truths, the self-evident truths that it fought for, are everybody's. They're human. They're the inalienable rights of all human beings, not just Americans. So the intention of America is not to go about changing governments. It's not these colored revolutions and regime change. It's to bring a sense of progress and prosperity and the ability to pursue happiness to everyone, everywhere in the world, as Roosevelt used to like to say. Everywhere in the world. This is not utopian. This is absolutely essential. So the fourth American Revolution, in this process of revolution, of the perfecting of this revolution, is the LaRouche Revolution. And that revolution comes from New York City. This movement was born in New York City. Wasn't born anywhere else. Why? Well, because of the special character of two things. One, that New York City is in constant battle for its survival, for the nation's survival, with this Wall Street host. That's one reason. But the second reason is what this city is, the sense of the city. Henry Carey says that the purpose of cities is to inspire people about the prospect for progress and for the future. That a city has a soul. When somebody talks about a city's soul, what they mean by this is that, is this sense of inspiration that you can derive from feeling, the sense of excitement, the sense of possibility. All right. There is no place, I maintain, in the world that gives that sense of possibility, of looking up, right? Of looking up and seeing this process, what human beings can create in New York City. There's no place. There are places that have an effect on people. Sometimes a romantic effect, Paris, right? Sometimes a cultural effect, even London, for example. But there is no place that has the excitement of New York City. And it gives its people, you, a certain sense of the possible. If it's not crushed out of them by some fascist down on Wall Street. All right, so the battle for New York City, the battle that created this organization, actually starts even before the organization is engaged in. Time in New York City used to be a saying about it, but most people may forget it. There was, you know, you talk about time, BC, AD, right? Well, in New York City, it's BL. BL, before Lindsay.
Before Lindsay.
Some of you were old enough to understand this.
The college system.
Before Lindsay. John Blake Lindsay, whose family ran First National Bank, became the mayor of New York in 1965 with the mission to destroy the city. Not to destroy it from the sense of bombing it, although the effect has been much the same, but to destroy it as a unified whole, to break it apart so that it could never challenge or in any way do anything to fight Wall Street.
Which bank did his family?
First National. Well, which is now combined with First National City, mm-hmm. and it becomes First Citibank. Right.
That makes sense.
John Blake Lindsay, right? Fair-haired boy, right? Handsome guy. A handsome guy. Starts off as a Republican goes to become a Democrat, then winds up becoming something called fusion. I think that's like metrosexual or something like that, I'm not sure. But he becomes the mayor. And what he does is he wages war against segments of the population. He wages war in particular against one of the bulwarks of the FDR system, something that FDR had created as a result of various pieces of legislation, including from the great New York Senator Robert Wagner, the Wagner Act, which is the trade union movement. The trade union movement in New York is different than any other trade union. It was born out of a social conscience. It wasn't just simply, you know, let's get some more money, right? It was always a force, all of the unions, right? The teachers union, the firefighters union, the police union, all of this is part of this tradition of coming from Europe, right? The European trade union movement is a little bit different than what the American union movement had been, right? So you have all these immigrants coming into New York City, the Irish, right? The Germans, and the Irish are in the police union, right? And the Italians as well, right? The Irish and the Italians are in the firefighters union. You have the Irish running, the most powerful personality in the trade union movement in New York was a fellow by the name of Mike Quill, right?
Oh, yeah.
The head of the transport workers union, the most powerful union in the city of New York, that stood not for just money for transit workers, but to protect the public from a subway system which was outdated in 1960, right? And a danger to both workers and riders. Mike Quill, the man Lindsay hated the most, right? Absolutely hated, said Mike Quill is the most evil person in the city of New York. But what was done was that they had two plans. The first plan was to segment the city, okay? Segment, divide it up into communities. And then give the communities the right to police themselves and to determine hiring of teachers, which teachers would go, which teachers not. In other words, to break apart the unified unions and have all the people answer to all these various community boards. Mm-hmm. This is called local control. Mm-hmm. It's a Ford Foundation policy. The draft that Lindsay was operating from was written for him by the Rand Corporation and the Ford Foundation. Community control is a banker's plot. I don't care what anybody says, it's no good. There may be community boards here, there may be many people, but it's counter to the principle of the indivisibility of this given area. It's a whole. New York City is not communities. It's one idea, right? And the only way you can fight Wall Street is from that perspective. From the standpoint of the country, it's one idea. From the standpoint of New York City, as representing that idea of the country, it's one idea. So they break the city up into these segments. Now, what do you do when you do that? Well, you have the teachers union, which is mostly white, mostly Jewish. And then you have some community boards, which are mostly black. And then what you do is you put you pay a handful of people, which that's where the term poverty pimp comes from, right?
Mm-hmm.
You pay some people, the banks pay some people. Al Sharpton is an example of this kind of guy. He seems to have lost most of his, mostly, I think that's part, maybe Wall Street sucked some stuff out of him, right? And he's come out thinner or something. I saw a picture of him. It is not the Al, the Al Sharpton that we knew back in this period was a fat slob.
Yeah, right.
He's still stupid, but he was a fat slob. Now he's a thin stupid person. So anyway, so we have these poverty pimps that are now organizing against the teachers union.
Oh boy.
They started almost immediately with the inception, and they start saying that it's a Jewish problem that the union has. They don't can't relate to black people. Now, this is the biggest bunch of garbage in the universe, because the trade union leadership, Al Shanker, and the leadership of the United Teachers, of the United Federation of Teachers, were some of the most progressive people who proposed programs to uplift children and give them an opportunity, even in terms of sacrificing money, salary, for the purpose of improving the conditions of education in schools, which were already 100 years old and should have been ripped down and rebuilt. Mm-hmm. All right, so the teachers' union is targeted. But the first wave of this, the first wave of this attack occurs against Mike Quill. Lindsay kills him. He murders him. He murders the head of the transport workers' union. In the middle of Mike Quill organizes a strike, Lindsay says it's against the strike, even though it's guaranteed under the Collective Bargaining Act, the Wagner Act. Lindsay gets some trumped-up judge to say the act is against the city charter, and they jail Mike Quill, and they don't give him any food, and he dies in jail of a heart attack.
Oh, gosh.
And Mike and Lindsay says it served him right. Okay, so that gave you a sense of what this was going to be about. Murder. Death. Murder. Okay. Now, what's going on at the same time? Well, you have some crazy people. They look like me. A lot like me. Who are running around on the campuses, sometimes a little bit high, sometimes not, and they're advocating all sorts of things against the war. They're fighting against the Vietnam War. They're advocating, and mostly they don't want to get drafted. Now, I'll be honest, right? That nobody wanted to be drafted, because the high percentage, and the only lottery I have ever won was the draft lottery. I was number four in the draft lottery. I won $1,000, but they said that was so that I could have a good grade when they sent me over there. There's the student movement. The student movement is penetrated heavily by other Ford Foundation operatives who are organizing in a group called the Students for a Democratic Society. Now, this group is not very much democratic. I don't think they really understood what the word society meant either, but they were students for the most part. Okay. So, the plan of the Ford Foundation is to take the leadership of this student movement in New York City and throw it against the teachers who have gone on strike to defend class size. They weren't fighting for wages. They were fighting to defend the class. Lindsay had cut the budget and was going to double the size of most classes. And the teacher said, we can't teach.
Yeah.
We're not going to teach. We're not going to be able to teach. And the community board said, you get the hell in here and you teach these people. We don't give a shit what you say. You teach.
What year was that?
This is 1968. Right? Teachers go on strike. Al Shanker goes on strike. Posters start seeing, appearing around the city. Jew teachers. Jew teachers go after the black people. Rally against the Jews. Right? Mm-hmm. Where's it coming from? There are people like Al Sharpton. They're putting up that sign. Meanwhile, inside the student movement, they are going to organize the student movement to go against the teachers and then bring the students to fight the teachers. Fight the teachers, beat up the teachers who are on strike. Bring them to Bedford-Stuyvesant, bring them to these other areas. It's in this context that the Labor Committee is born. That Lyndon LaRouche recruits from these students people who thought maybe this is a little crazy. Why are we going after trade unionists? Why is nobody attacking the banks? Why is nobody mentioning Wall Street? Why is nobody speaking about the fact that the war was not organized by Jews? You know? Why is anybody, where is this coming from? And Lynn has a plan. He's going to recruit from this movement, this rabble, the student, people who can think. And he's going to teach them so that they can think better, more clearly, that they can understand the principles on which we have to organize. And a principle that was discussed is this concept of something which is this concept of the indivisible whole. It's called, it was called then, because it was couched in some Marxian rhetoric, the class for itself, right? Meant that you don't organize separate things, you organize everybody. Everybody. Around what? Around things that are universally can be applied and are applicable to everybody. We need economic progress. We need more, we don't fight over what the Ford Foundation wants you to fight about, which is what? A shrinking pie. How are we gonna cut it up? There's not enough here. I'm gonna go at you with the knife. I'll go at you with the knife and we'll see who wins. And then if I cut you to shreds, then I get your pie. No, we don't fight on that. And so what Lynn did is he deployed himself and some of us and the other people into this rabble in the student movement with the idea of splitting it and preventing it from being deployed against the teachers. Because at the same time, if you remember, what was going on was a strike at Columbia University. The strike was against the war, and the plan was to shift it to be against the war and against the Jew teachers. And that was being run by a group of people who later were to become terrorists, the so-called Weathermen, the Weather Underground, right? Mark Rudd, this character JJ, and I'll never forget my first experience with the Labor Committee in some of this stuff was the fact that Lynn would go to these SDS meetings and he would heckle these jerks. JJ, you stupid idiot!
Whoa.
These guys would march around the stage, on the stage, they would be Lynn personally would do this. And he gave people courage. Now, the important thing to understand is that it is not in the character of New Yorkers to do what these people are being asked to do. And the fact is that the reason that it was going to probably work is that most of the people at Columbia weren't New Yorkers. Right? They really weren't. They weren't. CCNY was where the New Yorkers went to school. Only the rich brats went to Columbia. And most of the people that went there, they're coming from all over the place. So this is a different thing. It's not part of the state system. It's not part of the city system. Remember, the city system was unique. Why? No tuition.
None. At Hunter College, they were trying to organize for that. And I thought, what's this? What the? Nobody, you know, they were SDS.
You saw it there. But I'm saying the city colleges were out of the tradition of Roosevelt. You give people education. Why? Because it's in the interest of the country that people should be educated. So you're not going to charge them and have them have $100,000 worth of debt. What's going on now? College education is a debt scheme, right? Isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
You go to school, you wind up owing somebody huge amounts of money, and you don't learn anything anyway. And then you're never able to pay it back unless you get an amnesty or something. And you have to do that. You have to kiss various people's rear ends. So the idea was that they were going to do this, and we prevented it. All right, so Lynn is already becoming dangerous. But the city there's a problem developing, right? We didn't know this at the time, right? We didn't know this at the time, but there was already work being done on behalf of the bankers that were analyzing the effect of this segmentation of the city's population. Are they ready to absorb another series of blows in order to secure what was already becoming the debt within a global financial crisis? Just as today, right? Just as today, there was a crisis emerging starting in 1968, which Lynn was educating us about. We didn't really understand all of it then, but he was trying to explain this to us. And it was brought about by the fact that there was this massive speculation taking place in which bankers were making these huge profits on these speculative loans and then never paying them off, refinancing this. So what he did is he got us to do, he said, look, I want you to take a look at some things. Go look at the New York City transit debt, because I'll tell you what's going on. It's debt farming. Remember that word, debt. In New York, there are no farms, right? Last time I looked, there weren't any. Maybe we should turn Wall Street into a farm, but there aren't any farms now. All right? But there is farming going on. What do you grow? Financial paper, right? You take a debt and you give it to somebody fully knowing that that person, that entity can't pay it back, right? Can't pay it back, no way, but we'll take the fee and you'll pay some of the interest. The debt comes due because it's a short-term debt. Then what do? You refinance it. Say, okay, well, you can't pay this back. We'll take this debt and we'll lend you some more money. We make it even larger. More fees, more interest that still can't be paid. What do? Refinance it again. You refinance, you never pay it off, you just keep refinancing. The bank keeps making money. Debt farming, right? What are you growing? Profit for the banks. But what's happening to the entity? It's being bled through what? Through interest payments and through service fees for this debt. So we looked at the transit debt and we discovered that the subway system, which was originally developed by private interests and then taken over by the city, the debt of these private entities were taken over by the city. The subway system had cost several tens of millions of dollars. As of when we were looking at this, in the beginning of around 1970, beginning of 1971 or so, the transit debt that had been paid was in the tens of billions of dollars. So Lynn said, this is it. This is what we need. This is how you're going to explain this to people. It's relevant today in explaining what's gone on. This debt is illegal. Why? It's against the principle of the general welfare. It's savaging the debtor. Right? It's usury, which is against the law and against God as well. So the debt shouldn't be paid. We do not pay usury and we do not pay fraudulent debts. We will pay debt that is of value for something. We hold those contracts, we accept these contracts, we will not pay this debt. The debt should not be paid. So, we started advocating that there should be a bankruptcy proceeding on this debt and a lot of the other debts, because all of this was taking place with the city of New York as a whole, not just the Metropolitan Transit Authority, right? Because the city of New York would go and borrow money on the short term, it couldn't pay it back, would refinance, and so its debt had ballooned from several tens of millions of dollars to $14 billion, which could not be paid in 1974. Lynn said, unless we can stop this kind of policy, unless we can stop this kind of policy, the city's debt will explode and that debt bomb will blow up the entire financial system. Now you have to understand something. The debt of the city of New York in 1974 was $14 billion. The debt of Brazil, a fairly substantial nation, now one of the members of the BRICS, was $18 billion. Right? So the impact of a potential default on debt would have been devastating. Lynn said, this is a demonstration that the system that had come into being as a result of the financial crisis leading to the famous date in which the Bretton Woods system, August 15th, 1971, which Lynn had forecast that was going to happen, didn't know exactly the date, but it did happen. The Bretton Woods system was canceled. The system Roosevelt had created to give the world economic stability in a way in which development were possible. You could invest in long-term projects, projects that took 10, 15 years because you had achieved a relative stability in currency so that you wouldn't wind up, taking out a debt now, and then because currency devaluations, all sorts of, the debt was worth nothing 15 years when it came due. So Lynn said this was going to come to an end. It did come to an end. And as a result of the new system, which is the opening of the door of the casino known as Wall Street, right, or the City of London or anything, it's a global financial casino. That's what was opened when Bretton Woods was taken down. Bretton Woods was taken down and you replaced it with a floating exchange rate system in which currencies rose, prices, commodities rose, all sorts of things rose against the quote market, meaning you open the door for massive speculation. So Lynn now says, okay, fine. Let's take a look at the housing market. We just did this. We looked at the one other thing, that because this is also something to understand. When we studied the transit debt, and we studied the structure of the payment system, right? In other words, the fare system. What we found is that the administration of the fare system cost more than the fares collected. So that it were better to finance the subway system through a tax on Wall Street transactions and certain other increased taxes on real estate and real estate speculation. Eliminate the whole fare collection system. If you're going to, this is true, we then were able to discover that in general, this is true with every toll. Every toll, the system by which it's collected, as well as the inefficiencies that it causes in the economy. Right, for example, delays. All you need to do is go to the bridge, right? Rush hour. Mm-hmm. You see what we're talking about. How many hours are lost, the man hours lost, all of this stuff. You add all this together and you're taxing the economy by collecting these tolls and these fares. All right. So now we look at the housing market. And what we see in the housing market is that there is an open door. Lindsay has created an open door for real estate speculation. Totally open. You can speculate with impunity. No tax, almost no taxes. We found that 1/3 of all the city's residential tax and commercial tax was unpaid. And he made no effort to collect it. Right? Now, what were we doing as we're doing? This is how the battle is fought, all right? How do we get this stuff out? Remember, there's no Facebook, there's no Twitter, there's no emails. So you gotta do it the old-fashioned way, in the street, with leaflets. with people handing leaflets. Now, let me say something about this, because I assume it's true. I've spoken to Lynn. Lynn knows all about these kinds of things, Lynn Speed. But I want to also make sure that other people here that may be doing this. Look, New York is a different than people in other parts of the country. I can tell you this from experience. You go out with something like this, you hand leaflets. First of all, you're standing in front of a subway station, people coming up, people take the leaflets. Some of them stop and say, "What do you got for me today?" They want them. They want to know this. In other parts of the country, go away, go away. What are you? Who are you? Right? There, in New York, is completely different. People expect you know, there's something wrong, and they want to be told about it. And they especially admire the fact that we would be there. We used to have our newspaper, New Solidarity, and we would be there with our newspaper and with leaflets every day. Not just some days, every day, at certain places. At one point, during the crisis that I'm getting to, that has still haven't gotten to the full extent of what was happening, we were getting out. We could get out on any given day 200,000 to 300,000 leaflets. People took five, take six, then they weren't taking them and chucking them. You go in Washington, and people say, "Oh, I didn't wash them." People are taking out leaflets. Well, you see what happens with the leaflets. You do it. People take 10 leaflets and they throw 10 in the garbage can on the next block. Not New York. They're taking 10 leaflets. They're going to give them to somebody, and they don't ask for them unless they want them. So this is being fought in this. In other words, people are being given information completely contrary to what the Lindsay administration is saying. And people are getting it from who? Lynn and LaRouche. Every one of the things says, LaRouche this, LaRouche that. Just like today, right? And people are looking at this. And we're getting feedback. People are saying, we have meetings. People are coming to the meetings, right? And now Lynn says, look, the question of the debt. New York City debt is illegal. It's been debt farmed. Yes, pay the principal if it's truly and duly obligated. Hamilton, this is a Hamiltonian principle, right? Hamilton says you don't cancel public debt, right? You can refinance it on more favorable terms, but you don't cancel it. Why? Because it's a contract. Except under what? When that contract is a fraud, right? If they're causing you to incur a debt because the bankers have essentially a gun pointed to your head, that debt is an illegal debt. You're being forced to take on that debt. You don't need to take on that debt. So Lynn says this, only one way to deal with this, debt moratorium. It is in the city charter, it is in the federal constitution as enacted by the Congress, that governments, municipalities have the right to declare moratoria on debt. Why? Because if they can't pay it, they must not pay it at the expense of the general welfare. That is unconstitutional. In other words, taking money that you need to support the welfare of the citizens you're responsible for and giving it to a bank is unconstitutional. If you don't, to take it away from something is unconstitutional. So to do what is unconstitutional is to pay debt that's illegally incurred. What is constitutional is to stop the payment. Now Lynn was a pretty smart guy. Strange, I should say. But no, you're smart. It seems so simple. It is simple, right? You understand it. Don't you understand this?
Yeah.
Makes sense? You explain. Could you explain this to somebody? Sure you could. But what is it challenging? The entire financial system, including the current system, is premised on what?
Debt.
And what about the debt? that you're going to pay it.
Right.
That you're going to pay it. If you don't pay, the entire system and everything that it operates under is challenged. What do you think they're worried about Greece? Greece is a little nation, doesn't have a lot. But if Greece doesn't pay and bails out of the euro, says we're not going to kill our people for the banks, what is it saying? It's saying
we're not
going to pay.
Yeah.
The words that bankers fear most, debt moratorium, we're not going to pay. We're going to cancel. They fear this. Why? Because their entire system is based upon getting people to pay under the most difficult of circumstances, blah, 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 and then make you sound like you're a hero for paying an illegal debt. So Lynn says, debt moratorium. We're going to organize for this. Okay. Now, what's happening at the same time? Right? What's happening at the same time is that David Rockefeller, now, that's a phrase, name that doesn't, Rockefellers don't mean as much now, right?
Yeah.
Why? Because they died.
They died.
And they're old. And see, there's something interesting. There used to be families in America, an oligarchy in America, families, you know, the Morgans, everybody heard of them, right?
The Vanderbilts.
The Vanderbilts, the Rothschilds, right, let's see, you know, you can, the Astors, right? All these powerful families. Where are they now?
Dead, underground.
No, what kind of oligarchical family? Well, you have the Hiltons. Well, what, Paris Hilton?
No.
Is an oligarch? She's a slut, but I don't know about an oligarch. I mean, those are the kids have become what? Degenerates as a product of the culture that's been created by their what? By oligarchism. So they have lost the ability to be oligarchs. Because they can't continue the line because the kids aren't even interested in this crap. All they're interested in is getting high, getting laid, and God knows what else. They don't care about any of this. So you don't have a Rockefeller running in the banking, you know, running the banks. You used to have three. You used to have John D. Rockefeller, remember old shriveled John D. Rockefeller? Here's a dime, you know, I'll give you a dime, right? That guy, you know, his sons, right? Nelson, David,
Lawrence,
and John all were part of what? The banking family, right? J.P. Morgan's son, all part of the banking family. It started getting really a little dicey with the Mellons because, you know, I had this guy, Paul Mellon, whose father, Andrew Mellon, was the Treasury Secretary and also a prominent person within the Federal Reserve System. And he was big, the Mellon interest, right? Mm-hmm. And he, evil, British, and he once said about his son Paul, right, who happened to live out where we are in Loudoun County, he says, I think it would have been better if I put a pillow over him. And he said that about his public statement.
He said that about his son?
Yeah, because his son was a degenerate, right? And then he had another son, which was related by a marriage. Billy Mellon Hitchcock was even more degenerate than him. So what's happened is these families have disintegrated. You don't have them anymore, right? But back then you did. Rockefellers. Rockefeller were the most powerful, internationally organized British assets at that point. And so David Rockefeller, right? Chase Manhattan, right? Remember? Now it's not even, the bank doesn't even exist, right?
Yes, it does.
Morgan Chase. No, but it's combined. It's not as a separate bank. The Rockefellers would never. Yeah, they took over banks. They didn't combine and combine with other people to be taken over. Now, so Chase Manhattan Bank, David Rockefeller, was the centerpiece of the bankers that were running the Lindsay, had run the Lindsay operation, and now were about to do something else. Because they had analyzed the situation. The debt was coming due. The $14 billion had to be paid, and there's no means to pay it, even by extraordinary measures at that that would be acceptable at that point. It's an important point. Acceptable at that point. Wasn't ability to pay. So the debt's coming due. This is 1974 now. So he commissions the Rand Corporation to look at what Lindsay had accomplished. right? Because, you know, this is still the end of the Lindsay term. And they found that despite all of the attacks, the trade unions were still strong. The people of the city, despite the segmentation, would not accept certain additional drastic cuts. So the alternative was to go to take, forgo for a form of fascism. That was the only thing, to take the political power out of the hands of the people of the city of New York and give it directly to the banks. That was the only thing that would work to get, that would give a sense that the debt could be guaranteed. So, that's what they did. They made a decision. After they got this report, which was done in, by a group that was then in operation, since fallen by the wayside, called the City Club. This was done by the Rand Corporation. They started changing their policy all of a sudden to the government of the city of New York. They said, all right, the city would come, okay, can't pay, ha ha, just like before, can't pay. We want to recycle, okay? Give us refinancing. Refinance. No. We won't do this unless we have ironclad guarantees of repayment. What do you mean? Well, we want you to cut the budget. Well, you've got to cut the budget and guarantee a portion of this debt. Well, say, all right, we'll do some of that. We'll start doing some of that. But then it gets to the point where they can't do it anymore. Even the mayor then, this little pipsqueak guy, Abe Bean, was about this tall, right? What? Yeah, Abe Bean, he said, I'm not gonna do this, this crazy. They're gonna blame me for killing people. You want me to fire department people, fire police? I can't do this, the unions will kill me. So, okay, so what they do is he says, all right, go to the federal government. Go to the federal government, see if you can get some guarantees from the federal government for the debt, and we'll consider giving you some money if you do that. So they go, he goes, have Beam and a couple of people go hat in hand from the city council, go meet with, at this point, the government is, Nixon's out, right? And Ford is in. All right? Now, the government doesn't say anything. Then one day, we used to have our offices, if you remember, some of you, we used to have our offices over by Columbus Circle on the edge of the Garment District, right? And before that, in this time, we didn't have the offices there. We were right in the Garment District. We were down by 29th Street in a loft. We had our offices. This is where we did the research and we had, you know, communicated with the rest of the national, our far-flung international and national organization. And one day the phone rings. And I happened to answer it. I said, who is this? Hello, who is this? This is Bill Simon. I said, what? I said, this is Bill Simon, I'm the Treasury Secretary. I said, you are not. And it was Bill Simon. He says, what do you guys think? We've seen your stuff. What do you think we should do? What does LaRouche think? What do you guys think we should do about the New York City debt? He says, my inclination is I would like to support the city, but I don't want to give 1 cent to David Rockefeller.
Oh, I like this.
He's a little stupid, but he has. So Bill saw, so we said, well, that's generally the right idea. Don't give in and participate in this scheme to back the debt. Now, this is like what happened before the bail. It's the same kind of thing, right? Federal government's being asked to bail out.
To bail them out.
But Bill Simon's saying no. Now, So he goes and he says, no, we're not going to do this. Later, we said this. You know, I talked to him for about 10 minutes. Dave Goldman talked to him for about another 50 minutes. And he said, well, we'll stay in touch. And that's what happened. And that's it. Then Bill Simon and Ford tell Beaton no. And so the headline on the Daily News says, Ford to NYC drop dead. But that really wasn't true, was it? It was Ford to bankers drop dead. But that's not what anybody ever said, but that's this now is the truth. Now why think about this? The Treasury Secretary of the United States of America is calling up our office on Twitter. Now, if you ever saw what our office looked like, then you would really know why this is a little incongruous, right? Really? All right, this is a loft. I'm trying to remember, tell you what, you know, it's a loft. It's not a office, per se. It's, and he's calling in, he's calling this number that he got off a leaflet. Now, this is why I'm telling you this. Do you really know when you hand out a leaflet, when you hand it, where it goes? Do you have any idea where it goes? Do you know? You don't. You never know. So don't ever think that somebody's not paying attention. The guy that you're handing out a leaflet, you're handing out a leaflet on down Wall Street attacking those banks, the guy up in the top, you know, the penthouse in the executive suite is reading that leaflet. Why? Because it's from LaRouche. See, LaRouche was dangerous already, very dangerous. And people are beginning to fear in New York City, David Rockefeller's people in particular, are fearing what's happening about the debt moratorium. Because we're getting traction. Because now there's no way out. Okay, so they offer a deal, right? They will create a debt recycling mechanism that the banks will run, which they called appropriately Big Mac. A greasy piece of crap, right? Which you can choke on if you don't eat it right. All right, so this is the Municipal Assistance Corporation. All right, so we've now moved into a new phase. Debt farming is now debt recycling, right? Now what's recycling mean? What you're gonna do is you're gonna put it into this Big Mac machine and it's gonna come out as new debt. You're gonna take the debt and you're gonna issue new debt, okay? And that debt is going to be guaranteed by what? The blood of the people of the city of New York. The blood of the people of the city of New York. This is Shylock. Right? A pound of flesh. It's truly a pound of flesh because they're talking about where you're going to get this money from. There are no increased revenues. So the only way you can get this money is by cutting it from where? From your union, the teachers, from the firefighters, from the police. You have to cut services to people whose services have already been cut to the bone. You have to suspend capital projects on infrastructure that even in 1974 was ancient, right? Blood money, debt recycling. You're backing the debt. This new debt is backed by the promise of blood. This is a whole new phase. It's a different thing. This is actually borrowed from who? From another New Yorker. He lived in New York. He's actually a Nazi. His name is Helmut Schacht. He did. Oh. Oh. He lived in Brooklyn. Oh. Brooklyn Heights. Helmer Horace Greeley Schacht. Lived there as a youth, came back later, became the Nazis' finance minister. What time is it? Okay, so I don't have to speak up a little bit. All right. But we're almost done with this part, and then the other part is fast. All right. So, the Schacht had this idea that what you do is you, this is the idea of what secured the German, you know, debt. Well, the lampshades, right? Yeah, it's true. The blood of the, and sweat of the German people, right? Meaning cutting from programs to secure debt, recycling the debt, under what's called austerity. Same concept as what is being done in the Eurozone today. The same concept of what would be done if, for example, that to secure the debt from that Jupiter-size debt, to cut it from social services and so forth in this country. All right, now we've reached a detonation point. That's their proposal, and now some political people are scared. They can't do this. And so they turn to us, one of them in particular, Luis Olmedo, a city council person, tells us, all right, they've gone too far. I will endorse and support a resolution for a debt moratorium for New York City. The firefighters chief, Vizzini, good, solid Italian guy, tells me, he says, I've dealt with the mob. These guys are worse. This is worse than Murder Incorporated. I am not going to kill my members. I will support the debt moratorium. So you're starting to reach a threshold. Meanwhile, bankers, we have our ways of calling into the bankers. And we're calling into the bankers to find out what they're thinking about LaRouche. And as this process is going on, they're getting more and more hysterical. Top banker says, this could work. We're in trouble. All right, so then they go to the state and they said, all right, we got to offer a new deal. We're going to create a control board and take these decisions for a period of approximately 10 plus years out of the hands of the city government and make it by this fascist control board that's going to approve all the contracts, approve all spending, approve the budget, and so forth, so that the political figures, we give them a break. Meanwhile, what we want is the state to create under the second MAC, MAC 2 as it's called, a backing for the MAC bonds. They'll back the MAC bonds. In exchange for this, in order to sell this, and we are told by somebody very close to David Rockefeller that this only occurred because of what we did, our agitation for a debt moratorium, the banks agreed to cancel part of the debt. Now there's one other swindle that's got to work. That debt from those MAC bonds are essentially garbage. They're like junk bonds, really, because you know there's nothing there that promises anything. They're secured by all of this blood and so forth, but nobody knows whether it's actually going to produce anything. So really worth. So if you sold them on the open market, you'd probably blow up the thing anyway. So now what they say is, okay, fine, we've got to make the pension funds from the city's unions buy these bonds, whether they want to or not. So they go to this guy called Bumgut, we used to call him, Victor Gottbaum, who is the head of AFSCME and head of all the municipal workers, and they threaten him. And they say, you're going to sign on to this, and then we'll force Shanker and the rest of these people to come along. Essentially, that's what happens. There's an agreement to do this. Meanwhile, we are putting out leaflets like crazy, exposing this, calling for the debt moratorium. And so it's all coming to a head. There's a vote that's going to take place in Albany. Paul Gallagher and Anita and some of these other people are up in Albany. We're all talking to the New York people, the city people, and saying, you got to hold firm because we're trying to organize a debt moratorium vote that night in the city council. And we came this close.
Oh.
But they threatened Luis Olmedo. Felix Rowetton directly threatened Luis Olmedo. It threatened his family. They started circulating the news. Any trade unionist or any city official that goes with the LaRouche proposal will be jailed. But to Lewis, they said more. They said, it's like mafia. He said, You like your children? Lewis didn't want to back down. And if that had, if one person had stood up, others would have stood up. But they didn't, under this thing. And as a result of this, you have a horror show called the Emergency Control Board, and you have the effect of this, which you're still feeling, you're still feeling to this day. And let me just give you a sense of what actually happened. Right, well, of course, this is all unconstitutional. Every bit of what was done is against the constitutional because it operates against the principle of general welfare. It's all fraud. All of the people who did this are criminals. The deaths that occurred as a result of this are on their hands. They should have been jailed. And instead, people like Felix Rowerton is celebrated as the savior of New York. They put his face on, you know, on when he goes to a Knicks game. Why anybody would do that, I don't know, go to a Knicks game. But anyway, that he put his face on the thing at Madison Square Garden, and people cheer. People cheer. Now, there is a policy. Now that this is done, they become bold. They'd say, okay, fine, we're gonna tell people what we're gonna do. We are going to destroy the city of New York. We're gonna shrink it. We're gonna shrink it. And a fellow by the name of Roger Starr, who was a member of the New York Times editorial board, writes an article on the 14th of November, 1976, in which he calls for the planned shrinkage of New York City. And let me give you a couple of quotes so that you get the sense of what's happening here. All right. Planned shrinkage is better to read it.
His name is Roger Starr?
Yeah, Roger Starr, right. Planned shrinkage is the recognition that the golden door to full participation in American life and the American economy is no longer to be found in New York City. Right? New York can continue to be a city, but it must be with fewer people, fewer than 5 million. See, even before there was Prince Philip, there was Roger Starr, right? Because this predates, this is the same kind of thinking. Eliminate these people. So how does he propose to do this? He proposes to do this by cutting the services to the worst areas of the city, and then leaving those places, people to flee them, fires to burn, right? Murders to take place. And he actually says, the stretches of empty blocks may then be knocked down, services can be stopped, subway stations closed, and the land left to lay fallow. City leaders know that sections of the city are virtually dead. The problem has been that soft-headed leaders have tried to keep the dead areas alive. The city government is afraid to do what is right. Would they still supply services to the few survivors, send in the fire engines when there are fires, keep the subway stations open, even continue a school? In some of these sections, under pressure of a local city official, the city press to make new investment in housing, all this must stop. If the city is to survive with a smaller population, they must be allowed to concentrate. This is the concept of the green zone, right? That's what you have now in the city of New York. This is what has been done to the city. Go look at it. You have a few sections of the city of great wealth, the kind that you see on the television. The rest of the thing is a hollowed out core, sort of a Clockwork Orange. Inside, nothing, right? Nothing real, all surface. Now, this wasn't enough. So we decided that we interviewed Starr. And I did. Believe me, it was not very pleasant. and he said this is an enlightened viewpoint. Our urban system is based on a theory of taking a peasant and turning him into an industrial worker. Mm-hmm. Now there are no more industrial jobs. Why not just keep them peasants? He said, we are changing the role of the city. Stop the Puerto Ricans and rural blacks from living in the city. Reverse the role of the city. It must no longer be the place of opportunity for the poor, but a place where the rich can aspire to become richer and the middle class can aspire to become the rich. New York City should become the seat of a new financial empire and known as the capital of money. So this is what he's proposing.
It could be
so this is what was done. Let me give you an idea because I have to move a little bit more quickly now, so I'll go a little bit quickly. This is what was done to the city under Big Mac, right? In the first 6 years, 30% of all sanitation workers were fired, and those remaining had their wages and benefits cut by a third. 20% of the transit workforce was fired, with total spending by the MTA reduced by 30% and maintenance staffs cut by 35%. 25% of all uniformed police were fired. Enrollment in the city university system was slashed by 42%, while the tuition was imposed for the first time in history on the system. The fire department's budget was slashed by 35%, and over 10% of the firefighters were laid off. Tens of fire stations were shut and buildings put up for sale. And at the start of the city's time, Big Mac's time, there were 17 public hospitals, right? After Big Mac, There were a total of, in 1960, there were a total of 154 public and private hospitals. 3 decades later, there were 79. If you look at a map of Manhattan, in 1963, there were 6 major hospitals serving the area above 125th Street. By 1990, there were only 2. By the year 2000, half of them had their services cut. And then going back to what Starr said about this, I know what we did with the poor 100 years ago. We gave them tuberculosis. Some of us thought that they had found a way to extinguish themselves with drugs, but unfortunately that has not happened on a large enough scale to do what I'm talking about. Now understand what happened to the city also in terms of demography. The population of the city was reduced for a period of time by approximately 1 million people from the point before Mac to a point in the mid-1990s before population returned. Don't assume that all those people left. Don't assume anything. Some of them died, right? More of them died than should. would have otherwise without Mac. The other point is that when the population started coming back, who came back? Poor people? No. Mostly the middle class moving back from the suburbs into new areas within these residential green zones. The city is not the city that I grew up in, that you grew up in. It's been remade, it's been star marked, if you will, right? That's what's happened to it. And the people don't know this. They have to be told about this. Because in the end, the issue isn't going to be what they did. It's going to be what we do to change this. Now remember, at the same time that Lynn is agitating, in this same period, during the period of Big Mac, to stop this, he is also developing a flank. The flank comes out of proposals such as the International Development Bank, which is almost identical to what this new BRICS development bank is. He is developing a flank with his work, with the work that this movement did in Russia, in China, on the new Silk Road, and in India, with the, especially the Indira Gandhi and her son Rajiv Gandhi, in terms of organizing people around the concept of development, right? The large-scale development projects. So the United, what happened as a result of this crisis, right, in terms of what it did, the people of the city of New York changed, right? They took this, but how were they able to take it? By the fact that it has never been brought forth of what actually occurred. Instead, you're given this sob story that the city's debt problems were solved, right? That it's now a more leaner and better run city than ever before. That you had two great mayors, Giuliani and Bloomberg, right? Right. Exactly. And that these people have improved the city's life. But for who? And is it really improved? No, it's not improved. Look, for example, at the graduation rates. How many people graduate from, Maggie might know this, how many people graduate out of the city schools?
Not what used to, but Jessica, you're teaching them now, you might know.
Yeah, a lot less. Graduation rates are down to 62%.
Right. So 40% of all the students at this point, and this is cited as an improvement, do not graduate from high school. Right. Want to venture what the unemployment rate right now is among people between the ages of 18 to 25? 70%. 70%, and that is including the fact that most of these people, some of these people have jobs, but they don't have a job that they can support themselves or anybody else on. This is what has been done to our city, right? Meanwhile, I have this. Center for the Urban Future, a report that was put out this year on the city's infrastructure, okay? Listen to some of this stuff. The average age of the subway station, subway system, and so forth, 90 years. The average age of sewer mains, 84 years. The average age of homeless shelters, 70 years, which means that basically none have been built since those were built, or most, almost none, and during the Depression by Roosevelt, right? School buildings, 66 years. The average age is 66 years. But 30% of all school buildings are over 100 years old. So what are you looking at, folks? What's been done to your city? And then we have the debt. Okay, $14 billion was the debt. I have to find a little sheet of paper here, if you'll excuse me for 1 minute, I might be able to find it. I don't know that I can, but if I can, it would be useful. $14 billion was the city's debt in at the start of the physical crisis on the Mac. And now we're told that the debt, the crisis has abated, and that we have solved these problems, so to speak. Okay. At this rate, at this point in 2013, right, according to the figures that were available, without even by their standards, right, by the stupid way they report things, the debt of the city of New York is $61 billion.
Yeah.
Of which, half of it is going to be due in the next 6 years and cannot be paid.
Whoa.
But that isn't even all of it, because that, for some reason, they decided not to count $30 billion of debt. They just said, we're not going to count it. They're not counting the MTA debt. They're not counting the public housing debt. When you add that, it's $100 billion. At the point of Big Mac, the average debt per capita was around, that's, you know, roughly the same population before, you know, 7.5 million or so. Now we have a little more than 8 million people, right, 8.3. At the start of the Big Mac crisis, the average debt per capita was about $1,400 and some odd dollars. The average debt right now, almost $9,500, right? In 1990, that debt was $2,000 some odd. A 218% increase in 20 years after it only doubled in the previous, less than doubled in the previous 10. But that isn't the all of it, because they discounted the debt. They don't count it right. They refuse to count it. If you count all the debt, short term, long term, everything, the average debt per capita is $16,000 per person. Hmm. 16 times what it was under Mac. So what did Mac do? It transferred your blood into the vaults of the bankers in Wall Street, and now you owe more than you ever owed, and it cannot be paid. It cannot be paid, just as that debt, the derivatives debt, none of this can be paid. They will try to pay it.
Oh, yeah.
And they will force a level of austerity on this city, or attempt to, that will cause even greater harm, perhaps. But here's the flank. Why do we have to take it? Why should we take this anymore? Why do you accept the arguments that the city has improved, when everything that I've told you is the city is much worse off now than it ever was, which is lawful from a Hamiltonian standpoint? Why? Because under Hamilton, what generates value? Human beings. You invest in human beings and in the infrastructure to support them. Big Mac, Rowitton, the bankers did the exact opposite. The net effect is to cause an explosion of debt. This is the same reason why the rest of the debt, it's all speculation, but it's also caused by this concept of this thinking of bankers about taking blood to secure paper. This organization was built on the proposition we would not allow this, that we fought. We were the only person in the student movement, nobody thought about these things. They were too concerned about what was going on in other parts of their bodies. They didn't really care about this. We were the ones, and we didn't just organize among students. We went out and organized everybody on this. New York City is to this nation, right, what this nation is to the world. It is its symbol and its reality. We took in millions upon millions of people and created this country. New York is the melting pot, not the whole country. That's garbage. The whole country isn't the melting pot. This city is the melting pot. This city operates from the principle of hope. People came here, as the Lazarus poem on the Statue of Liberty says, right? The tired, the hungry. They came here for what? With the hope for a better future. The bankers have tried to take that hope away. Can you do that? No, not unless you let them. And the issue really isn't and so much about what role we have given the world by what we've accomplished in this city over the course of the life of this city, the opportunity that we now have to save it. The LaRouche movement fighting in the city of New York was fighting on the same principles on which the BRICS now fight. We're not being asked to, quote, join the BRICS. That's not what's going on. The BRICS are us. They're us. They're what we should be. What we need to do is become ourselves. Mm-hmm. Who we really are. Not some people that applaud Felix Rowitton at a Knick game. There are despicable people walking at the bottom of this island. Those people have to be held accountable. But with the possibilities that we have created to create this new just world economic order, to move in the direction that the LaRouches have been proposing for the last 50 years. We have now the opportunity not only to save the world in the abstract, but to save this city as well. Because when there's an infrastructure, the infrastructure deficit for the city of New York is conservatively estimated in terms of what, just to maintain what exists, is $50 billion between what is proposed, not what is spent, but what is proposed and what might be required according to this report. But that's nothing. Why do we want to have a subway system that doesn't work, or school systems that are maintained but don't educate? Why do we want housing, the housing stock that's 100? We need to rebuild the city. There's no way to do this from the standpoint of Wall Street. That will never happen. If we are able to change this system, this city can and will be rebuilt. The cost doesn't matter. We will rebuild it from the bottom up. But to do that, those people on the end of Manhattan have to be taught a lesson. And the lesson is that the people of New York City will not forget what they did to them. And they will pay a price for this. And it isn't going to be counted in blood. How many of those bankers have gone to jail?
None.
Well,
in the White House.
That's right. But, well, how do you put these people in jail? Who's going to put them in jail if it isn't New Yorkers? Mm-hmm. So there's your mission.